smile at me and really ease the pain. Hold it.
My name is Lady Ryan. It's an honor and a pleasure. Thank you.
Sunny. Yesterday my heart was filled with rain. Sunny, you smiled at me and really eased the pain. Oh, the dark days are done and the bright days are here. My sunny one shines so sincere. Sunny one so true.
Aya klai kahiki nai kumu kahi klai ki ola ye monate a mona lo yelo ha yao hilo na kahi me kauwa kini le hu le I na kahi ke ala me ke ona na o pane ba e aloha e.
Aloha mai kako, aloha to everybody and greetings. My name is Kavika Kekeli'ihi Wahiwa Alfiche, and I'm a native San Franciscan, and I'm kumuhula or hula master for Halawa Kekeli'i, a school here in South San Francisco. That chant I just shared marks a new day. It honors the rising of the sun and also makes a special prayer for rainfall, which we desperately need right now. I also pay respects to my kumu, my masters, Rei Kaikila Lani, as well as Lanikila Kekeahi Ali'i Naope. I would like to make an important acknowledgement to the Ramatush Ohlone, whose lands we occupy here in Yelamu, also known as San Francisco. This has been Ramatush Ohlone land since the dawn of time. In addition to acknowledging these lands, we should all consider reciprocity and what that means and entails. The lands here, especially San Francisco, has a special connection that dates back to the late 1700s with Hawaii. Our last king, King Kavikalakaua, loved San Francisco and spent his last days here before his passing in 1891 at the Palace Hotel. Finally, I would like to say a big mahalo nui loa. Thank you to the Northern California Grantmakers Organization and to all of the attendees for all of your work in supporting our work as cultural practitioners. I'm now pleased to introduce a special performance by Ayana Albertson, writer and spoken word poet, who in April was crowned the winner of the 2021 World Poetry Slam. She joins us today to share her original piece for today's conference entitled Healing Humanity. Please put your hands together and welcome Ayana.
We live in a world of depth and diversity, of broad possibility and endless opportunity, and still, somehow we have managed to minimize our potential, to prey on the impoverished and bask in our abundance. We serve selfishness on a platter, forget to give folks a fair share, and have the nerve to call everyone equal. There is a message here, and it won't always be to everyone's liking, won't satisfy their ego, might taste a little bitter if you're not used to humble pie, but feel free to feast on this. Truth is, allyship is not a costume to remove when it benefits you to do so. To disassociate when solidarity threatens the safety of your convenience, we do not seek conditional comrades. Those who fight to feel good about themselves and not for the freedom of others, humanity has always been about collective compassion. Even when society seems more like compartmentalization, it is knowing that some things may make us uncomfortable, how critical it is to confront our biases, to know that community extends beyond the neighborhood you live in or the people you consider common, how it is constructive and caring and critical when need be. It is a seed worthy of nurturing, of commitment and kindness. And who are we to neglect the growth of others, to call ourselves good and then prosper off our greed? It is our duty to strengthen those who struggle, to eliminate the margins and expand the means. It is not enough to stand beside if the oppressed still must suffer alone. How some folks don't have a home to go home to, or a glimpse of hope to hang on to, and I'm tired of tiptoeing around the truth, how it's impossible to pick yourself up from the bootstraps if you keep being robbed of your boots. So I petition we be privy to the privilege, address the discrimination in the disbursement of our dollars, break down the barriers of bigotry between us. We must hold each other accountable, resew the fabric of our nation, support the systems that support the people, and acknowledge the beauty in our differences. We are capable of this kind of cleansing. A revision and rehabilitation together, we can find the hope of humanity if we simply start the search within ourselves.
Wow. What a powerful grounding combination to start us this morning. That was Ayanna Albertson, writer, poet, and award-winning spoken word artist. And thank you to Kavika Alfiche, the Kumahula of Halawa Kikiali, for land acknowledgement. In this moment, we cannot ignore the continuing human costs that our conflicts over land exact, particularly on indigenous black and brown populations around the world, be it in Palestine, Somalia, or right here in the United States. We must be vigilant and committed to stopping the loss of life. There is a better way. And once again, thanks to the tight beats from DJ Lady Ryan. What could be better than hearing Lady Ryan at a conference? I'll tell you what, day two of NCG's annual conference. In case you're just joining us for the first time, I'll do a recap of day one. Two scorpions won a debate. Funders explored philanthropy's role in addressing racial equity. We celebrated 40 years of NCG, welcomed in three new board members, and shared our strategic vision for the next 5 years. Today, we'll explore what to do when shift happens. We're living in a moment of constant shifts. We see this so visibly in our region: the housing crisis, economic hyper inequality, rise in hate crimes, climate exacerbated wildfires, and much more. We know business as usual is insufficient in a world where everything around us has shifted. The needs are more urgent and our neighbors are hurting. The time to act with our full humanity is now. How philanthropy will respond and change is really up to all of us. This will be today's focus. We'll start the day with the conversation between Taj James and Kat Taylor. Taj is an old friend, a parent, a poet and practitioner at the Art of Social Transformation, the founder of Movement Strategy Center and Full Spectrum Capital Partners, and he's co-founder of CAT, of the Giving Pledge, the Good Life Pledge. Kat Taylor works in service of restoring racial and social justice and environmental well-being to a more equitable, inclusive world. Among her many social enterprises and philanthropic ventures focused on deep systems change, she serves as co-founder and board chair of Beneficial State Bank and founder of Tomcat Ranch. They've been working closely together to find creative solutions for our greatest challenges. The second half of the day will enable all of you to actively engage with us to generate new ideas, explore what's possible, and start the journey with us in realizing a new way for philanthropy. We encourage you to chat, ask questions, and share resources. NCGF will be actively paying attention on Swapcard. We'll be collecting everything coming in. Before I bring Taj and Kat to the stage, I want to first take a poll of the audience. The poll question is as follows. What is your assessment of how philanthropy is doing in response to the racial reckoning that emerged in 2020? A, philanthropy's response is fine just as is. B, our work needs to be radically imagined. C, we're not sure where we need to be, but we're making progress. D, not sure. Put in your results now. Things are coming in. So, again, A, philanthropy's response is fine just as it is. B, our work needs to be radically imagined. C, we're not where we need to be, but we're making progress. And D, not sure. It looks like we have some emerging consensus, 71% saying we're not where we need to be, but we're making progress. We'll explore that more in this conversation as we go forward for the next 40 minutes in dialogue and then about 20 minutes of question and answer. Now it's my pleasure to introduce you to Kat Taylor and Taj James, coming to you together in one room, with no mask, fully vaccinated, in person from San Francisco.
Thank you, Duane. And thank you to the NCG community. It's so good to be back with all of you in conversation and dialogue. This is such a powerful and important community of philanthropic practitioners, trustees, executives, folks playing such critical and important role in the process of getting resources into the hands of those who need them. And I think about this conversation as a gathering of those who believe in freedom. If you know the Sweet Honey and the Rock version of that freedom song, we who believe in freedom shall not rest until it comes. And there's much work to do. As the heartbreak of last summer brought to all of our attention, and as the conflicts and strife that continue in our communities and around the world persist, those who believe in freedom have got to come together to figure out what and how we can do to address that. So I want to appreciate all of the wisdom that's been shared before from Vanessa and Pia and Vinny and Edgar and Fred and Serena and Julia and Glenn and Eric and Steve and so many other luminaries and practitioners in this work of transformation. And we want our conversation to build on the wisdom that's been shared and go from there. And as we get in there, how are you, Kat?
Great. Happy to be here. And I just want to say how excellent the opening offerings were. Thank you. I'm a lifelong learner and I just got filled up with a bunch of goodness. So thank you.
Yes. And it's always hard to follow the poets, because anytime the poet speaks the truth, I kind of am like, well, what do we do now? Because the sister just shared everything that needed to be shared, said everything that we need to do. And there was such potency and power in that wisdom, in those words. The challenge is, when the truth is spoken, how do we live into it? Speaking the truth is hard. It takes courage. Living into the truth is messy and complicated and tough. And that's why we have to do that in community. So today we're going to go on a little adventure. NCG is famous for bringing together conversations in new ways, and we're going to try to do some innovation. So this conversation is going to be a little bit of the Red Table, and I'll be Jada, a little bit Oprah, a little bit Angela Lansbury. We're gonna try to solve a mystery. So here's how it starts. I'm going to tell you how it ended, and then we're going to try to figure out how we got here. On October 21st. At 9 a.m. on the main stage of SOCAP, this woman to my right, Kat Taylor, was in conversation with another colleague and luminary friend of ours, Regan Pritzker from the Cattelli and Lieber Foundations. And they were in conversation, much like we are in today. And in that conversation, Kat announced to the SOCAP community and to the entire world that you were going to be transferring a third of all of your wealth to community ownership and control, not as a gift, not as a grant, not as a loan, not as an investment, but as an asset transfer. Reparations, land back, asset transfer. What were you thinking? And where did you come from, right? So those of you who know Kat, hearing that, if you knew that already, it may not surprise you if you know Kat well. But for those of you who don't know Kat, this is a chance to get to know Kat and her journey a little bit better. Because to understand where that commitment came, we need to understand a little bit of your story. And I want folks to get a chance to hear how you got here. So, I want to see if you can share a little bit about, like, how did you become someone who believes in freedom, believes in justice, and was willing to take risks to try to figure out how we live together in this place in a different way? Where did it all start?
Well, I might make two acknowledgments and then I'll go into that. One is, I'm super nervous today because I feel great responsibility to this community of philanthropy, and especially the Northern California grant makers. And so I want to state on the record that I believe that honest reflection, radical reform, structural change in the arena of philanthropy is an act of love. that's what we do with those we love the most, is we're super honest and we want the best for the community. And so just to acknowledge all the very fine work that many of you on this call, most of you on this call do, notwithstanding the need for reform in philanthropy. I haven't traveled this journey alone. So I come from parents, a father who is a huge advocate for challenging authority, even his, and a mother who is a feverish do-gooder. I also have had the great fortune of being partnered with Tom Steyer for almost 37 years now. And in addition to providing for our family, he has been a lifelong learner and change maker as well. So my earliest memories are probably at the age of 5, watching the television funerals of the great civil rights leaders as they were assassinated. And I remember it was very somber, not just because television was new and we'd watched it all together, but even for a 5-year-old, I understood that there was something deeply problematic with our country's origins that managed to propagate over 400 years of violence, oppression, and injustice. So I awoke early to a need to change things for good, but I also have been subject to an education that was inaccurate. So I was a student in public schools, and then I went to a private high school, and then to elite colleges and universities. And I really have to examine what I've been taught, because often it was not accurate. And I think that is kind of endemic to a lot of the work in the United States context, that we have not told our history accurately. So on the journey, retell the history accurately. Tom and I partnered up. We had a family of 4 kids, each living their own one wild and precious life. He built a business and investment firm. He accumulated a lot of wealth on our behalf. We engaged in conventional philanthropy, which was not very effective looking back at it. It was sort of friends and family giving and not to structural change. We did reassess everything when John Kerry was not elected president. You remember that was the other time we went to bed thinking one thing and found out another. And we weren't going to Washington with that administration, particularly Tom wasn't. So we decided to upend our philanthropy and create social enterprises that could work at the heart of these troubled systems. We called them good food, good money, good energy, kind of kindergarten terms. We started Beneficial Bank at the heart of good money, followed by the 2 venture funds, Bright Path and Radical. We started Tomcat Ranch at the heart of good food. And Tom started looking into good energy and climate issues, which he quickly surmised was not a business or scientific problem. It was a political will problem. So he founded Next Gen America, Need to Impeach, and ultimately ran for president. And all of this gave us insights into what needed to change in the systems. And that was the point, to be actors, gaining those insights and figuring out how not just to be a good bank in a bad system, but how to change the banking system for good. All well and good, but it still wasn't enough. In fact, taking the bank as an example, providing debt to communities who have no wealth is not everything that they need. And it isn't even something they can access without wealth. So we've been thinking a lot about policy legislation, rule changes to get the rules fair at the outset. But this is where it came into my thinking that unless we shift assets, we cannot compensate for centuries of disinvestment, societal assault, and the stripping of wealth from communities who, by the way, were the large part of creating the wealth in the first place. So we need to talk about cultural and narrative shift as well. And we've resuscitated Tomcat Media to do that. But our main conversation today, I think, should be about why we need to shift assets, how to make simple commitments around that, and then get into the messy engagement that's required to make that come true.
Mm. what I really appreciate about your journey is, and the story that you just told, is sort of a recognition that for change and transformation to happen, it's both about the particular and the whole, right? So to sort of think about how we change within specific systems, you know, regenerative agriculture or the energy system or the food system or the financial system, and that in the work that we all do as change agents, it's important to have strategies that are system specific, right? And to sort of get to a place in the work where you realize for us not to just make incremental reforms, but for transformation to happen, it requires a sort of more holistic and integrated approach. And we understand in powerful ways the ways that the problems are connected, so the solutions have to be connected. So I think one of the things I appreciate about kind of the vision and the approach that you bring in the Good Life Pledge is that recognition that it's, yes, it's good money and it's good food and it's good energy, but it's really about all of it and how it comes together. And I think in working with communities, that's, you know, for us in this sector, we may come in and say, oh, we have, you know, money for education or money for housing or money for this. You sort of talk to a mother who's trying to get her kids to school and get to her third job and keep the lights on and keep everyone safe. I just want my kids to be safe. I'm not a silo in your funding strategy. I'm a human being in my family, in my community, trying to help my kids stay safe and survive. So often the way that we interact with communities doesn't reflect the holistic and integrated, you know, sort of aspect of life. So I just really appreciating how this sort of moment in the Good Life Pledge is also a moment of really embracing the complexity of issues and the need for holistic approaches. I wanted to see if you could talk a little bit more about like the importance of assets, because what's so interesting to me is that I feel like we kind of have a little bit of a blind spot, right? Sometimes when we say, oh, okay, we think that people who don't have assets need assets, right? As someone who started a bank, I can give you a loan, but if you don't have any assets, I can't give you a loan. So I created a whole bank, but the bank can't address poverty because poor people don't have assets, right? It doesn't work. Sometimes when we talk about in this context, people start scratching their heads like, well, do people really need assets? How do we do that? So can you talk a little bit about, as someone who has a lot of assets, how do people with assets think about assets and the importance of assets?
Sure. So first, recognizing you put your finger on the flaw in our social enterprise approach, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't have done it or that we won't continue doing it, but three things. One, inherently, those are white-led social enterprises because we started them. So one of my mantras is put more in different people in charge. So we need to figure out a way to shift decisioning power to more in different people, especially those from communities that have been hurt first and worst and have the best wisdom about the solutions that are holistic and can rebuild wealth and prosperity and a good life for all. Second, these systems are all overlapping and interdependent. And essentially, we're at a point in human history where we need to shoot the moon. We're going to have to win every suit, every hand, do everything at once, make the problem bigger. If you can't solve a problem, make it bigger, because then you see all these interdependencies and the way that they interact with one another, these systems. And then also, there, while we serve community in these social enterprises, we take our understanding of their vision and commitments and dreams by proxy. We kind of assume we know what they want as opposed to putting them in charge. So this is where the social enterprise work had to transcend and move to shifting assets to community control and ownership, so that we are literally putting the community stewards and communities in the driver's seat, because they understand what they're dealing with, what they need to solve for problems, what they need to thrive. the reason that I've started focusing on assets is because I noticed that wealthy people have assets. They're less concerned about current income. They're very concerned about building wealth and increasing wealth. And from that wealth, those assets, comes the current income that they need to live on a yearly basis. The flip of that is, if I'm a mother who is fervently trying to provide food for my children, and I am underpaid like most American workers are, and I can't make ends meet, I don't have any facility or opportunity to build wealth, because I need to divert every penny of current income to feeding my children, just as an analogy. So where is the potential? Who has the potential to build assets and transfer them whole so that a community, a household, an individual who's living hand to mouth can have an asset base from which to thrive, and also to deploy those assets in ways that are community first, community led, and community benefiting. Mm-hmm. So, and when I say assets, I don't just mean financial assets, although certainly, you know, and I take this page from your book, Taj, you know, looking at assets, first, we got to get them out of the bad stuff, get them out of fossil fuels and private prisons and extractive finance. We got to try to get them into the good stuff. And we got to change who gets to control all these assets. When everybody owns a little bit of everything, we'll thrive. When anybody owns too much of anything, it tends to corrupt the system towards self-interested activities for the powerful. Assets could also, I think this is a very important asset class, which is land. Land was stolen from Native American peoples, and it was denied from Black farmers after the Civil War. And it has been stolen in other ways as well. There's a wonderful paper called Bleeding Albina, The Story of Portland. And the perspicacious Black and brown and mixed communities that built their own world in the presence of extreme racism and discrimination, only to have it stolen through broken levees and floods, disinvestment, a poor tax base, eminent domain, redevelopment. And for all that happened in Vanport and Portland, that's the story of almost every American major city. So land is a really important tenet of the land rematriation, is going to be a really important part of shifting assets.
It reminds me of, you know, we had the opportunity to spend some time last weekend in Ramatesh Ohlone land, next to the Friendship House, where we came together with our friend Peter, who was leading a ceremony with the community around the village to honor the vision and the life of Helen Wakazoo, who's the founder of Friendship House. And that day was really about exactly what you're talking about. Indigenous communities, for those of you who don't know, most Native Americans on these lands live in cities and not on reservations. And in the Bay Area, we have family here from many nations. And Helen, as someone who was displaced from her family and her land through the boarding school process, came to the Bay Area, sort of created a community to bring and serve many nations here. And one of her dreams and her visions was to have a place, to have land and a place where the communities could sort of come together. And I just wanted to see if you had any reflections from that day of celebration and ceremony and remembering, and we're sort of in a time in which, you know, through the work of Sagorite Land Trust here in the Bay Area, Ohlone people have begun to reclaim more and more of the territory that's been taken from them over time. And here in San Francisco, Ramatesh Ohlone are just had some of their ancestral territory returned to them through a partnership with the Post Land Trust. And so this process of land return for Indigenous peoples, which is really critical to the return and repair work that we all need to do, all of us who are land stewards. Just wanted to see if you had any reflections from that day. And as you think about the work that Peter's doing and the work of the village, and the village is one of the communities that's the focus for the Good Life Pledge, one of five communities that we are working to bring assets and resources to, so that land return and that land stewardship can happen. But just the land stewardship is the foundation and the basis for stewarding other assets. The six-story building that's going to be built on that site, that's going to be an engine for healing and economic revitalization for Indigenous people in this place. So just wanted to see if you had any reflections from that day. It was a powerful and really moving day.
Yeah, absolutely. So much appreciation for being part of that ceremony as well. So I think what I took from it is how powerful culture is. We, in sort of modern Western society, we think of rules and laws and property rights and, you know, systems like that as what holds our society together. But the longest standing people of the world were able to persist and thrive mostly from cultural norms. And one of those cultural norms that I think challenges the very nature of property rights is that our ecological commons are stewarded in common, that they belong to all of us. And really, who gets to control land should depend much more on who will steward it well for common purpose and sustainability. So we have been working with the village actually for some time with Friendship House, because the young women from Friendship House came on the ranch property, oh gosh, 10 or 12 years ago, something, for one of their ceremonies. And they've expressed that that's a really important piece of access for them as well, as getting onto land, not just to steward it in terms of agriculture and forestry and other things, but also for tribal ceremonies and the deep connection to the land that those cultures held at their heart. So we are in the process of converting Tomcat Ranch Educational Foundation, which is the private foundation that stewards the lands formerly of the Muwekma, another tribe of the Ohlone peoples, formerly stewarded by the Muwekma, take those lands and convert Tomcat Ranch Educational Foundation into a public charity over the 5-year application process. And that's to position the ranch and its lands to be available for a common public interest stewardship, not only by tribal interests with whom we are building rapport, but also for Black farmers who have been denied access to land, for LGBTQ plus who have suffered discrimination in the system, for regenerative organic production that is allegiant to the values of those longstanding cultures as well. In fact, a return to traditional foodways is really what regenerative ag is. So partnering regenerative ag with allyship, racial equity, food sovereignty, we hope to get to a place where Tomcat Ranch lands are stewarded by people who are committed to restorative agriculture, who hold the lands in ownership for the collective, and open up much more access to the land in future. And we'll work closely with Friendship House on their needs in that process as well. I think the other thing from the Helen's ceremony is just how important the community engagement and visioning process is, because Friendship House has hosted space for the community to come together and suggest what their holistic solution set is. And it includes wonderful expertise that they already hold, like tribal treatment centers, tribal ceremonial space, support systems for the community, albeit in an urban environment. So we're on a journey with them, and we will learn so much more as we go forward. But it is really important that we work with these communities to develop a good life for all.
Really, really, really inspiring. I think I think as we're in this process of as Dwayne mentioned, this moment of reckoning, we really have to, and as you talked about, kind of really facing our history and acknowledging the truth of how we got here. We have to start with those first wounds, and we have to do the work of repair and reparations in relationship to those first those first wounds. I think what I also want to sort of lift up in what you're saying from a practice and practitioner standpoint is that the commitment is simple, right? Okay, we have this ranch, we have this land, we're committed to returning it to the people who should steward it. But that's not a simple question, right? There are different communities have different relationships to the land. We've got the indigenous people, the farm workers, Black farmers, and sort of how do you create a process and a space for folks who all need to participate in this work of repair to kind of be in community to work that out together. And I think just, part of what you said before is like, you want to solve a problem, make it bigger so you can see how everything's connected. The other thing I really appreciate about how you're approaching this is sort of, if you want to solve a problem, get the right people together and do a lot of listening, And as a human being and a practitioner in this change work, one of the things I really appreciate about you is both the quality of your listening and the joy that you take in learning in relationship and your ability to sort of find leaders who really know how to put communities first. Leaders who really, because they listen to the community and they're able to bring the community together, they're able to do really amazing things. And I wanted to see if you could talk a little bit about our friend Harold, who you brought into our life. Because in some ways, part of the mystery here is is that Kat got connected to Harold. Harold is a legend in the environmental justice community. I'd heard Harold's story, but I'd never met Harold. And I met Harold through Kat, because Kat met Harold and realized what a remarkable community leader he is. And Harold has now changed all of our lives, because we built a whole learning community around the lessons from Harold's work. And out of that learning community is really where the Good Life Pledge comes from. So getting back to our little mystery construct here, Harold is key to the mystery of the Good Life Pledge because Spartanburg, South Carolina, and what has been accomplished there and what they're doing there now is really remarkable and transformative. So could you tell a little bit of the story of like, why were you in South Carolina? How did you meet Harold? And what are we learning from Harold, and how has Harold sort of changed our lives?
Sure. So my partner, Tom Steyer, on his quest to help this country attain climate justice and reparations, ultimately decided to run for president to instill those issues more firmly into the conversation, the presidential conversation. And we went on the campaign trail with him. He actually met Harold first when he was in South Carolina and visited Spartanburg. Spartanburg, 20 years ago, was a community completely beleaguered with societal assault and challenge. So there were two Superfund sites on where a coal ash plant and a fertilizer manufacturer had been, four brownfields, zero public safety, a lot of crime and violence, very degraded housing, a railroad line that cut the community in two for hours of each day and prevented people from getting to the hospital urgently, creating unsafe conditions for children, very poor public amenities and infrastructure, and the community getting sick, people dying of cancer and liver disease and all sorts of horrible conditions imposed by largely the pollution, but also just stress and poor living conditions. And Harold was one of the people who became sick and pattern solved to recognize that his, many members of his family had grown sick and died in his community, and somebody had to do something about it. So he stewarded a $20,000 EPA planning grant into a community engagement and visioning process. And just to cut to the chase, over the next 20 years, parlayed that small grant and that community vision into $300 million of capital investment into Spartanburg, creating 9 federally qualified health clinics, a massive amount of affordable housing, some leased to own housing, community centers, new industry. They're on the verge of starting aquaponics manufacturing. They're now on the also on the verge of establishing a power purchase agreement order with some of the local industry and generating your own electricity for sale into that. So he's really led an incredible equitable community economic development effort. He's a very authentic community leader, so much so that whatever had to be done, he was willing to do, including running for office. And he served 2 terms in the South Carolina legislature. But he also lifted up all the other informal cultural leadership in his community, encouraged them to run for local office, statewide office. Everybody joined working councils. And so it was a real community-led, community-first effort. And for all that it's been very successful and a standout, there are communities all over the country, especially ones who've been under that kind of duress, who are populating community visioning, engagement, and development efforts with authentic community stewards and leaders. And it's they simply need to attract more resources. So this is a lot of the impetus for the Good Life Pledge. We've, you know, selected 5 communities that we think are on that journey and want to transfer not only current grants, but also assets to, and put them in a learning journey, in a learning community with Herald and Regenesis Project and other leaders like Push Buffalo. There's incredible work going on around the country, but the campaign really elevated the need for the government also to support these communities. And we're so thrilled about Justice 40, the Biden administration's commitment to send 40% of the environmental justice resources to frontline communities like Herald's. There's much more work to be done. And it is hard. It is hard to execute. So we need accelerators and mentors like Herald to help communities so that they can learn from some of his experience and accelerate their journey, because we cannot win, as they say now, winning slowly will be losing. So we have to win fast all over. I did want to just say, call out one of the 5 communities, in addition to Friendship House, Urban Tilth Cooperation Richmond, Anasa Troutman and the Big We Foundation, Doria Robinson at Urban Tilth, Anasa Troutman at the Big We Foundation and Claiborne Temple in Memphis, Tennessee. There's also the Allensworth leadership in Allensworth, California, which was the first Black community in California. Colonel Allensworth was the highest ranking Black officer in the Union Army, and he recruited a band of former slaves to come to California and establish a community that he believed would become the Tuskegee of the West. They built their own town themselves from scratch on the edge of a lake and a railroad spur in Allensworth, 70 miles south of Fresno. It's preserved to this day in a state park that has preserved all the buildings. So you can see that they had a general goods store, a hotel, housing, livery, industry. And they built this thriving community at the beginning of the 20th century that then was brought down piece by piece through white supremacy and societal assault, the draining of the lake, the removal of the railroad spur, ultimately the assassination of Colonel Allensworth himself. So with that amazing legacy, the Allensworth leadership, the Allensworth Progressive Alliance, Denise and Coyote Cadera, stripping over my words, and Dennis Hudson, Denise and Dennis are the twin offspring of their mother, who was the matriarch of Allensworth for decades. She fought off 14,000 animal CAFOs, dumping toxins. She kept that community intact. And they are now in her, as she's passed, in her legacy, they are taking the community forward in a community engagement and visioning process that centers regenerative agriculture at their development, agrotourism, the rebuilding of their local economy. And I will remark that they are all African American, as their forebears were, but the community of Allensworth is now 95% Latino-Latina. And they are just making, hewing together into whole cloth, a brand new community with hope and aspirations. And that's one of the communities that we will help with how, getting resources and assets to. Just another community story.
So many stories to tell. And I think what's as we sort of get close to moving into some conversation with Duane and some question and answer, want to talk a little bit about what's wrong with philanthropy? Why isn't philanthropy good enough, right? And so you and Melinda Gates and many other people were leaders in the Giving Pledge, which was a sort of a community that's committed to give away, half of your wealth in your lifetime. So you and Tom had already committed to giving away half of your wealth. Why commit to giving away a third of all your assets? Why isn't philanthropy good enough? Why isn't philanthropy gonna get the job done by itself?
Yeah. So an article came out today, actually pretty devastatingly honest about the shortcomings of the Giving Pledge and of philanthropy in toto. And I, again, as an act of love, I am engaged in deep reflection on what needs to change in philanthropy. I'm part of something called the Initiative to Accelerate Charitable Giving, trying to realign the incentives of philanthropy, which right now are not strong enough to overcome the propensity of philanthropy to further concentrate wealth. Money begets money, and particularly some structures in philanthropy like donor advised funds allow donors to commit their dollars to philanthropic giving without actually giving it away yet. I know this is a sophisticated audience, you know how donor advised funds work, but those DAFs can pass down generationally. There's no requirement to give anything out from them. And the tax deduction is taken at the outset, which can amount to up to 74% of the total gift if you combine all of the various tax deductions. And we must always remember that that's diverting government tax proceeds from vital needs like public education, community safety, climate mitigation, et cetera. So it's not free. And it does seem to have further concentrated wealth. Philanthropic assets have risen rapidly, especially DAFs, and the amount of charitable giving has stayed flat. So more and more of those assets are sidelined, and they create power for those who created them. Influence, access, leverage. So what needs to change about philanthropy is it needs to be committed to reallocating power and wealth in society, not to reinforcing it. And I don't see any way that that's going to happen through pure grant making. The 5% is not going to wag the dog of the 95%. Money begets money. So these assets are just going to continue to grow if we don't figure out a more rapid way of deploying them in favor of community purpose and ownership. So I'll leave it there, but I'm looking forward to working with you all on how we can create better incentives for charitable giving, but also recognizing that if we run society right and there's a good life for all, we just won't need as much charity.
Amen to that. And I think I'll just share my little poem about this because I think we may be blessed with a song from Kat and You know that guy, Shakyamuni Buddha, that people talk about that guy? Well, apparently he sat under a tree for a long time and he discovered the truth of reality. And you know what he did? He just sat there, dumbstruck. He couldn't talk because he didn't know what to say. So the thing about poetry and the thing about song and the thing about the truth is, like, some of the things that are most profound cannot be captured in words, right? It's a paradox about the truth. And when Kat sings, what comes through when you sing is the love that you have that's in the words and beyond the words. So I'm gonna try to make things very simple here with a little poem for you all. Energy is energy, water is water. Capital is energy that has to flow like water so that healing can occur, right? It's very simple. Like, part of where we get stuck is just, well, there's the grant and there's the loan and there's the equity and there's the asset and it's just money, it's just water. And the only question is it flowing or not? And who decides where it goes? That's really always the only question. So in addition to doing things big, we have to do things simple, right? Which means it's not really gonna work if your program officer and your investment advisor and your family office, like, those people don't talk to each other because the assets are the assets. And if you put the assets in the hands of different people and don't allow them to talk to each other, that doesn't mean that water is not water. That doesn't mean that money is not money. That is all a construction. And that construction, those barriers and boundaries between the different kinds of money, that is the source of ongoing harm. It is the source of ongoing harm. So what I really appreciate about you, Kat, and you can take us out with a song, is that you're not saying philanthropy is bad. You're just saying it's just one tool, right? The bank is a tool. The foundation is a tool. The land is a tool. The assets are a tool. And the question is, can we actually bring all the tools in the toolbox, put them in the hands of the communities and the people who have the solutions to their own problems and just get out of the way? It's really that simple, you know? And if you go back and look at what you heard from Edgar and what you heard from trust-based philanthropy, trust-based asset transfer, we're all saying the same thing using slightly different words. It's all very simple. Just put the resources and support in the hands of the people and sort of just let go a little bit of the paternalism that says, like, can we really trust them with, you know, we say that the community is at the center, but do we really trust the community? And so if you apply the principles, the Whitman principles of trust-based philanthropy to all asset classes, you'll solve all of our problems. That's kind of what we're talking about with the Give Life Pledge. Don't just give the grant, transfer the endowment. Transfer the productive assets. So anyway, we'll get more into this, but I think we need a song, Kat. And I know that I know you got one for us.
Randy Carlisle has one for us. Thanks for time. Hang on, just hang on for a minute. I've got something to say. I'm not asking you to move on or forget it, but we need better days. To be wrong all along and admit it is not amazing grace, but to be loved like a song you remember, even when you've changed. Tell me, did I go on a tangent? Did I lie through my teeth? Did I cause you to stumble on your feet? Did I bring shame on my family? Did it show when I was weak? Whatever you'd seen, that wasn't me. That wasn't me. Oh, that wasn't me. When you're lost, you will toss every lucky coin you'll ever trust.
And you'll hide from your God like she ever turns her back on us. And you will fall all the way to the bottom and land on your own knife. And you'll learn who you are, even if it doesn't take your life. Tell me, did I go on a tangent? Did I lie through my teeth? Did I cause you to stumble on your feet? Did I bring shame on my family? Did it show when I was weak? Whatever you'd see, that wasn't me. That wasn't me. Oh, that wasn't me. And I want you to know that you'll never be alone. I wanna believe. Do I make myself a blessing to everyone I meet? When you fall, I will get you on your feet. Do I spend time with my family? Did it show when I was weak? When that's what you've seen, that will be me. That will be me. That will be me. That will be me.
Thanks, Tosh. Thanks, Kat. That was fun. So now we get to play with Brother Duane. Come on back in and let's continue the conversation.
Excellent. Thank you, Kat and Tosh, for your commitment, your drive, your heart, your voice, and leading with action, encouraging others to join you. Want to acknowledge that we experienced some connection issues for some folks along the way, so know that the conversation will be available quickly on recording in case you missed any parts of that. I have about 30 questions, but they've told me I can't ask them all. We also have some questions from the audience. But I just want to start by asking, you know, when we thought about who could have this conversation, it was a pretty short list. People who are of ultra high wealth, who are thinking the way you're thinking. The polls at the beginning, only 1% of our audience said they thought things were going okay. Is that the feeling you see amongst your colleagues in the ultra high net worth community? Do people feel like things aren't working the way they are?
You know, those who have the power to change the status quo rarely use it because it's where their power comes from. This is just a fundamental human proclivity. And I'm going to go to cultural norms. That article this morning was a real calling out. Like, if you're not part of the solution, you are definitely part of the problem right now. There isn't a lot of company out there right now who wants to shift assets or even, you know, make the giving pledge come true in reality, that those, you know, now the giving happens up to of 50% of the wealth. But I think there's room for improvement, and there's now impetus, because I think we're at a point in human civilization where it's going to feel scary not to be on the right side of history and not to, you know, make philanthropy work better at a time. Like, what are we waiting for? Why are we not breaking the piggy bank right now? We've got five cascading crises parallel moving right now: racial reckoning, climate, economic downturn, pandemics. So I hope people will see how much more they will thrive when all communities do.
Great, thank you.
And Blaine, go ahead. Yeah, just to sort of build a little bit on that, I think when I think about Kat, I think about Regan and the Catelli Foundation and what they're doing that's very aligned with the work of Kat and Swift. And I think there is a small and growing body of folks who understand that this is the way. And part of that is sort of generationally as well. So the younger generation of asset holders who are coming forward today, who many of us work with, are really wanting to go down this path, and they're just waiting for the year in which the assets are going to be in their hands, and we're going to see a lot more movement in this direction, which is really exciting. And on the philanthropy side, if you look at the Justice 40 commitment of the Biden administration, the Donors of Color campaign, around 30% of the resources going to frontline environmental justice groups, I think we are seeing shifts in this direction, and it's not the majority, but it is a growing critical mass. Because as Kat's saying, now is the time. And if you're really serious about transformation, this is really the path.
And thank you, Taj, for mentioning, because I'm following those folks. I'm sort of in the 60-year-old category, looking at younger philanthropists who are just breaking the molds and being bold about it. Thank you for their leadership.
I want to encourage our audience just to continue to share questions. Also, things that most resonate with you. I'm seeing a huge stream of resources. Really appreciate those. Please keep them coming. One question from the audience, putting more and different people in charge is a great idea. What are some of the best practices to make sure it's done in an equitable way? So it's not just new different people perpetuating racism or other harms.
Yeah. Well, so this is where it gets messy. Like, who am I to determine who is the authentic community stewards are? We do our best to listen and learn and follow what we think is the community's urge of who will be leading and helping. I think we have to also not just reconcentrate wealth in someone else's hands. So we are very committed to collective ownership models, moving the bank into a realm where it's currently owned by nonprofits, but create other ownership opportunities for other stakeholder groups, like the employees, like community members, and so on. Thinking about the ranch moving into some sort of agricultural-based cooperative model so that everybody owns a little piece of it, but not, as you say, just recreating the problems, you know, somewhere else that we are trying to flee in the first place.
Yeah, I really appreciate, Kat, your sort of commitment to not just sort of shift power, but restructure power and restructure ownership. And one of the things I'd point to in terms of what you shared earlier is that you focus and we focus, and a lot of the work that I've done over many years is about how to do the kinds of community planning and engagement that can really bring together diverse stakeholders to come up with community plans and priorities. And so the leaders that you've supported, the leaders that we work with, are ones who have a track record of really bringing diverse members together within frontline communities to come up with shared priorities. And so there's a lot of strong practice in that down that path that we can all draw from as we try to answer that question.
Mm-hmm. You know, you mentioned Taj, Kat, as a strong listener, and that is an asset in this work. I would imagine for some people trying to get into this kind of moving of assets, the complexity and understanding the systems is a real challenge. Any thoughts on how we get people not to be daunted by building the landscape knowledge you have of you know, the ecosystems you're trying to navigate? And you've been partnering with Taj, and I'm sure that's been helpful. What do you do if you have somebody who's interested, but just a little intimidated?
Well, I think increasingly there are sort of communities of learning and practice where this work is happening. And you're gonna sort of hear about some of those opportunities within NCG after this conversation, the ways that the NCG community can kind of take on these challenges as a community. But there's really interesting work happening with justice funders through the Meister program. You've got a number of kind of philanthropic collaborations and rebranding initiatives which are coming forward that are kind of focused on folks who are doing philanthropy who want to do integrated capital work and think about, okay, the philanthropy, the PRI, the MRI, the endowment, the family office, how do we sort of align our capital institutions more fully with impact? One of our founding partners at Full Spectrum is the Impact Finance Center based in Colorado, and they have a whole set of resources and supports for foundations, corporate foundations, asset holders who wanna sort of learn about how to do this. So there's both really important kind of like learning opportunities, communities of practice, and places where you can kind of just put your money together and kind of learn by doing. And so we had a big event yesterday, where we kind of came together to collectively launch a new effort that Harold from Regenesis is launching with some other partners to try to bring some sort of capacity building support to the communities that are doing this, so the lessons of Regenesis can kind of be shared with other communities. And there's a kind of a capital learning community forming out of that that's bringing together philanthropists and investors who want to figure out how to learn about this approach so that we can sort of do that in community and in collaboration. But I think what's exciting right now is there are a number of opportunities like that. You know, RSF's Integrative Capital Fellowship is a place where a lot of really important learning innovation is happening. So sort of the sector overall, I think, is starting to recognize that you can't just focus on the grant making. We've got to deal with the other 95%, all of the assets, and we got to figure out how to get more assets into the hands of communities. So I feel like there's a real burgeoning of opportunity for learning and practice that's happening.
Question about capitalism. How much time do we have, right? and I guess the question is, you mentioned part of the issue is taking the money out of the things that are harmful and extractive. As you've been doing this proactive work to move assets to community ownership, how has it been going on the back end, trying to make sure your money's not exacerbating those conditions? Has that been a struggle, or have you found that it's actually easier than you would think to have your resources invested in productive means?
Well, getting out of the bad stuff looks like a cleaner roadmap, but it is more complex. You know, if where does your commitment to be clean of fossil fuel support, you know, end, since most of the economy still runs on fossil fuels? But that is, you know, certainly our first step was to get out of pernicious investment activities and try to stay out of them and not get into new ones. But it's hard. That's hard, and we haven't seen enough divestment in this country. And you know, some of our leading educational institutions won't even buy into disinvestment. So our divestment, sorry, not disinvestment. Proactively investing in positive activities, I would say that was our journey and chapter of social enterprise development. And I'm really glad we did. I think those institutions are adding a lot of value. But again, that isn't taking the next step, which is making sure investment choices and decisions can be made by communities for communities. And that's where, for instance, like Taj was just mentioning, which I think is the way we can all move forward together, is to be part of these learning communities of practice. And yesterday, in the launch of Regenesis Institute and the Communities First Alliance, some of the chat was, how can you ensure that shifting assets to communities doesn't create displacement and gentrification? So communities are very attuned to that risk, and we need to support their strategies to avoid it, but it also needs to be part of our commitment that we just won't create conditions that tolerate displacement and gentrification. Mm-hmm.
Excellent. You said something that's, I think, a core paradox, or maybe it's a conundrum. I'd have to think about it. But this notion that we have to win fast right now, we can't win slow. And yet we always say that, you know, that relationships are built at the speed of trust, and there's harm that has to be undone. How have you guys as a team navigated that duality in this moment?
Yeah, I think that there are a lot of any serious change process is about managing complexity, paradox, and tensions, right? And it's about how we sort of hold those tensions in balance. One of the conversations that happens in this space is around this concept of capital absorption, right? And sometimes what that means is like, oh, okay, movement for Black lives, all of this stuff is happening, but there's a sense within philanthropy of like, oh, do the communities have the capacity to steward, absorb, and manage capital at scale, right? And on the one hand, the answer is no, because we'll send you a link to a website where you'll see communities that have gone through the kind of planning process that that Cass just described, their integrated capital needs in terms of grants, debt, equity exceed all of the everything you have in your endowments right now. They're ready to absorb, right? And and they need capacity building so that they can absorb more. So it's tricky, because the sort of capital absorption issue sometimes gets used as an excuse to reinforce the paternalism that says, okay, we'll just take care of this over here on your behalf. We're gonna invest this on your behalf, and then we're gonna take the surplus and we're gonna give you the surplus, as opposed to saying, does a community have the capacity to invest in itself right? To generate its own surplus through the stewardship of productive assets. The answer is yes. We have a lot of places where that's happening. And so there sort of is a tension and a paradox, because there's sort of a little bit of truth in that. But the important thing is we don't use that as an excuse to.
Well, that also presumes that, in fact, in private industry, where this wealth was made, we never made mistakes, slipped, stumbled, or lost money. So, you know, what is capital absorption really? But
well, I mean, you look at this in sort of like the VC context of like, okay, which entrepreneurs are allowed to fail and which ones aren't? Which entrepreneurs are allowed to get a lot of money, create a company, lose all their money, create a company, lose all their money, create a company, lose all their money, and get more investment? And then which entrepreneurs you're not given that privilege. And we know exactly how that works. We know exactly how that breaks down. And that basic principle essentially applies to all aspects of capital access. The rules of capital access, the rules of due diligence, are essentially the micro politics, the micro aggression of white supremacy, right? So you have to dismantle the ways in which certain people are approved for a loan, certain people are not approved for a loan. How a house is appraised, if the person puts black on there, I've gotten 3 checks from banks having been discriminated on home ownership loans that I've been a part of, because you check black on the box and you end up the victim of a lending discrimination. And then that happens to lots of people. And then you get a small, like $25 check to compensate you for the discrimination you experienced. That basic feature of the financial system exists in all aspects of the financial system, philanthropy included.
Right.
Just to say, I think it's an excellent point that relationships are built at the speed of trust. And that's why mentors like Harold at Regenesis are really important, because it's not for me to go to a community steward and say, you should do this. But we want to create that community practice that allows for more rapid adoption of beneficial investment practices or community building or whatever it is that it made Regenesis successful and will make other communities successful. And the tensions are replete. So our commitment to the 5 communities is a $100,000 capacity building grant to each to, you know, help them be ready to absorb capital at scale, used however they see fit. And then the pledging of $1 million of donor advised fund assets against a low cost nonprofit bond financing. And then the devolvement of that DAF asset to the community at the end of the lockup period. So basically giving them a balance sheet that allows them to access capital markets more cheaply, and then giving them the asset at the end. The tension is, why don't you just give us $1 million? We need $1 million right now. But then the assets never get built. So we're trying to sort of drop in a ready-made asset that leverages up to 4 or 5 times that amount of money in low-cost capital. But that's a healthy tension. And I totally understand when the communities push back and say, like, what, you're still controlling us. You're still controlling how we use that asset.
The other piece of the commitment there is we've committed to find the equivalent of 4 other asset holders, philanthropists, investors who will match the commitment that CATS made into each of the 5 communities. So we're both sort of putting in resources and then inviting other people to sort of join us in the journey. And becoming a part of the Good Life Pledge in this way is a great place to learn, because it's one of the sort of distinctions between, you know, the work that you did in sort of launching the Giving Pledge and the Good Life Pledge, is that there's both a focus on sort of economic power building in the context of cultural, political, economic power, focus there, but also the pledge is being launched in partnership with a set of communities whose work embodies and exemplifies the kind of economic strategies that allow communities to build community wealth and to advance their own economic development goals. And those 5 communities are representative of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of communities across the Bay Area, across this country, who are engaged in similar work. So we want the lessons from these 5 communities to sort of catalyze resources into communities across the board.
Really appreciate that. Question, Kat, Spotify playlist. I hear that these songs of yours are amazing renderings at many of your speaking engagements. So we want to know where we can find that. I actually do want to ask a couple more questions and then going to give you some food for thought in the audience to carry into the break and as we go into the afternoon. But before I do that, I guess, what do you think, Kat, will be the catalyst that will help more philanthropists, individual high net worth, but institutions as well, start this journey? If you had the ability to quintuple the participation or raise it 40-fold, what do you think would be the catalyst to make that happen?
Maybe companionship, going together. As Taj was just saying, we're recruiting four other donors for each of the five communities. So we can, you know, try to take some bold action, listen and learn from community leadership, and hopefully achieve a bunch of success that has thwarted us so far. That's the positive hook.
Yeah, and I think the thing I would just add to that, and it's really reflects the spirit of this conversation and what the invitation has been throughout the NCG conversation the whole time is, as Ms. Maya Angelou said, you know, when you know better, then you can do better, right? And what last summer the racial reckoning was about is now you can't say you don't know better. Right? The truth has surfaced in a way that it is undeniable, right? And so the question is now, are we going to do better? You have to make the commitment. Even if you don't know how to fully live into it, you just got to make it. And then together we can figure out what to do. We can navigate through the mess in relationship, in trust. But you got to just make the commitment, big and bold and rooted in an understanding of what we need to do to put new and different people in charge, because that's the only way we're going to get out of the mess we're in.
Appreciate you. Are other pioneers, Nasa Troutman at the Big We Foundation in Claiborne Temple, you know, a bunch of West Coast, I think women philanthropists saw the promise of that community development effort and came in with capital at scale to not only rescue the temple, but also to, you know, create a real, community economic development effort at scale in an area that affects many, many Black families and community members.
We're going to move to the speed round. I've got time for two more questions, and then I'm going to give an assignment to the audience during the break. The first question, Kat, when you say asset as distinct from wealth, are you referring to the balance sheet that you just referred to? Someone just wanted to understand the difference between the asset distinguished from wealth.
So the way I think about it is we are transferring a discrete asset, a donor advised fund asset, to pledge as collateral against a nonprofit bond financing. The activity of having that low cost capital and then the DAF asset redounding the community at the end of the financing is what creates the wealth. So the asset is needed to provide an equity platform against which to build wealth. That's what these communities lack, is any sort of equity.
And I think for those of you who want to get a little bit of deeper dive into some of the work happening from the community context, you watch some talks and listen to Amaka Agbo, who leads the Catelli Foundation and has developed a whole really powerful framework around restorative economics, which relates a lot to sort of what those of us in the Bay Area were very inspired by in the work of Casa Justa and Alameda County Public Health when they did that really critical report around development without displacement, which raised the issue that the only way to do economic development in low-income communities in ways that doesn't create displacement is through a community wealth strategy. Community have to steward 30% of the land, 30% of the jobs, 30% of the housing, in order to stabilize a community in an economic development context. So a lot of the work that's happening in this space really depends on the thing that you talked about, Kat, of like, you have to not just shift assets, you have to restructure ownership as you shift assets so that the ownership of those assets are held in the community. That's what creates the community protection. So it's not just sort of shifting individual wealth, it's building community wealth. And that's core to what we're doing in the Good Life Village.
And just a shout out to the community foundations, because they're going to help us propagate this. That's who, the partners with whom we will collateralize, dedicate DAF assets to collateralize these financings. And in a sense, they can productize that and make that an offering to their other DAF holders as another recruitment strategy. But they have the place-based, long-term horizon, community first aspect that we need to accomplish what Taj was just saying too.
As Fong puts a couple of questions in the chat for the audience to think about during the break and carry in the afternoon, I want to ask one final question. In 30 seconds or less, each of you, Taj and then Kat, what are you most excited about in the next 5 years of this work?
One thing we haven't talked about is healing, because I think yesterday Brother Eldra from Inside Circle is one of the other communities that we're working with in the Good Life Pledge, and we're going to see some links in the chat about Eldra, and watch those links and listen to Eldra's words, because in the work that we've done to try to do policy and systems change over many years, we have to contend with the fact that, like, our communities have been historically traumatized by systems of power and continue to be. So even in the aftermath of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, the murders of Black people basically have continued without any significant change. Right? So the trauma is both historical and it's still continuing. That trauma makes it difficult for us to believe and dream and imagine that things can be different. Right? And so for the policy and systems change and all of the things we care about to work, there has to be support for the healing work that we need to do as individuals and communities to have the courage to do the hard work that we have to do. So I think the thing I want that we hadn't said, I just want to leave folks with is that, this is heart work. This is heart work. Fundamentally, we got to remember who we are, how we're connected, the fact that we are interdependent, and we got to do that heart work if we're going to do this systems change work. It has to be at the center.
Okay.
And apologies that I left Elder Jackson III, Aspire Housing, and Inside Circle off of it when I was talking about the five communities. They're one of our beloved communities as well. But I'm most excited to see a mindset shift where instead of looking at communities, the frontline communities, as sort of deficits and victims and not powerful, that they actually lead us forward as a human civilization into a much better world. And we start seeing power as existing in all people.
Thank you both for such a rich conversation. Thanks to the audience for your active engagement. Thanks for the work you do. And we're going to take a short break. We want you back here at 11:10, I believe, to begin our next portion. And we also are going to hear some more tunes from Lady Ryan. So take care of business. We'll see you back here shortly.